So good afternoon, everyone. Today is 16th of October 2020. So we are going to present the topic conversion of epsilon NFA into DFA. So I am Ritika Parekh, and my other group members are.
I am Pradeep Chatterjee.
I am Safiya Akbar.
So, before starting, let us go through the contents. So, we will be discussing introduction. Within introduction, we will be talking a little bit about finite automata, DFA, NFA, and epsilon NFA. Next, we will point out some difference between NFA and DFA. Next, we will discuss some gate level examples regarding the conversion of epsilon NFA to DFA. And finally, we will end the topic by giving some MCQs and discussing some important points about NFA and DFA. So, Pradeepto, please start the presentation.
Yeah, so I'll be discussing the introduction, and I'll be starting with the finite automata. So, the finite automata mainly used to recognize patterns. It takes the string of the string as inputs and change its state accordingly. So when the desired symbol is found, then the transition occurs, and at the time of when the transition occurs, the automata can either move to the next state, or it can stay in the same state. Finite automata also have two states, accept state and reject state. So when the input string is processed successfully, then it is called the accept state, or either otherwise it is called the reject state. So when it will processed, then the automata finally reach its final state, and it will obviously it will be accepted. Also, this finite automata can be classified into two types. One is deterministic finite automata, and another is non-deterministic finite automata. This is the main backbone of this presentation, DFA and NFA. So this will be discussed by my teammates. So please carry on.
Okay, so let us first discuss about DFA. DFA is an acronym for deterministic finite automata. So in DFA, for each input, we will have a specific, one and only one specific state. So let me try to explain it with the help of the example. So here, in this example, we are trying to design a DFA in which every A should be followed by two B's. So input alphabet is A and B, and language which has to be accepted are ABB, ABBA, BB, and so on. So here we can see from state A, when we are giving input A, then it is going to state B, and only state B, no other state. And again, when we are giving input B, it is remaining, it is going to state A itself, it is remaining in that state. So for each and every input, we are having just one particular state. So this is meant by this is DFA. Everything is deterministic. We can determine everything clearly. That is why it is known as deterministic finite automata. Now let us go through the formal definition of DFA. DFA can be represented by 5 tuple, Q, sigma, delta, Q naught, and F. Q is a set of finite states, sigma is a set of input symbol, delta is the transition function, and Q naught is the initial state, F are the set of final states. So for this particular example, A, B, C, D, E, these all are Q, that is the set of the states. A is the initial state as well as the final state, and A, B are symbols. So next, Safiya, please explain.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Safiya, and I'm going to explain what is NFA and epsilon NFA. And as we can see that NFA, for a particular input, there are many possible states. The states are non-deterministic. So, and Here is the example. And in this particular example, we are going to design a string that ends with A. So we can see that the alphabets are A and B, and the string can be generated are A, A, B, A, A, B, A, B, A, B, A, and so on. And we can see in the figure that on giving input A, it is going to on a state A, and it's also going on state B. So it can go on two states. So now coming to the definition. And what is epsilon NFA? Epsilon NFA is the NFA which contains epsilon moves or null moves. And here is the formal definition of NFA. An NFA can be represented by a 5 tuple Q, sigma, delta, Q naught, and if, where Q is the finite set of states, and sigma is a finite set of symbols, and delta is a transition function where the delta goes to, on giving a particular symbol sigma, it goes Q to 2 to the power Q, it can go. And Q naught is the starting state, and if is the final state. So we can see in example. Here A and B are Q, small a and B are alphabets, and B is the final state.
So now let us discuss the very conceptual thing, the difference between DFA and NFA. This is the fundamental of all concepts. This will make a crystal clear concepts for any layman to understand this entire topic, the difference. And the difference, as the name suggests, DFA and NFA. DFA stands for deterministic finite automata, and NFA stands for non-deterministic finite automata. Here's the first difference, the name. Then the another difference is, for each symbolic representation of the alphabet, in alphabet, the alphabet of automata, there is only one state, only one transition state in DFA. And in the case of NFA, no need to specify how does the NFA react according to some symbol. There is no need. So we can easily understand this topic. Another thing is, DFA can use empty string transition, where NFA cannot use empty string transition. In the case of DFA, next possible state is distinctly set. We cannot change it. But in NFA, each pair state and input symbol can have many possible next state. This is here we can explain a little bit that in the case of DFA, we cannot judge any possibility. We cannot say any probability that where the next state will occur. It is fixed. So in NFA, there can be many possible states, many possible next states. And the another point is, DFA is more difficult to construct. Difficulty level is higher in the case of DFA, where NFA is very much easier. So this will clear the main difference and fundamentals of NFA and DFA. So next portion will continue, Ritika.
Okay. So here we are going to discuss a problem statement. So here is our problem statement. We have to convert the following NFA into its equivalent DFA. As we can see that this is a NFA, epsilon moves are there, and like for one particular input symbol, there are many possibilities of other states. So now we have to convert this NFA into DFA. So the first thing what we do for the conversion is, we have to find the epsilon closure of the initial state. That is, we have to find the epsilon closure of Q naught. Epsilon closure means on getting epsilon as the input, which are the states which can be reached. One important key point to remember here is, we always have to include the state for which we are finding the epsilon closure as the output. So Here we are finding epsilon closure of the first state, that is Q naught. So for Q naught, we are getting Q0, Q1 and Q2. Let us define this state as A. Now the next step what we have to follow is, we have to find the transition function of A on getting the input 0 and on getting the input 1. So on getting the input 0, again we are finding epsilon closure of this delta A comma 0. So here we are replacing A with this particular Q0, Q1 and Q2. Sorry. Then on finding it, we find that we have to find epsilon closure of Q3. And epsilon closure of Q3, we get the result as Q3. So Q3, we name it as another state B. So we have to follow this step again and again until we reach no new states. So we will stop once we have covered all the states and when we are getting no new state. So finally, our resultant DFA will look something like this, where on getting input A, when we are on state A, on getting input 0 or 1, we go to state B. From state B, on getting input 0, we go to state D. On getting 1, we go to final state C. And from C, we can go to D by getting input 0 and 1. And on getting input 0 and 1, we stay in state D. So the next example will be explained by Safia. Safia?
The question is, convert the given NFA into its equivalent DFA. So we can see from figure that there are three states Q0, Q1 and Q2. And on giving input 0, it's going on Q0. And here is also epsilon move from Q0 to Q1. And on giving input 1 at Q1, it's going on Q1. And also there is an epsilon move. So like that, we can proceed. So as Ritika said, we have to find the epsilon closure of the starting state first. So epsilon closure of Q0. So we can see from the given question that epsilon closure basically means, if you are not giving any input, then what are the state that we can go directly? So on giving, if you are on a state Q0, then on giving input epsilon, we can go on Q1 and Q2. So, and Q0, Q1 and Q2 will be our next state, and we can define this as a state A. So we have to find next the transition of A at input 0. So we are finding the epsilon closure of A at 0. So we are putting down at A Q0, Q1 and Q2, and so here we are finding the same state Q0, Q1 and Q2. So we can also name it as A, and so on. We will continue. And we will stop only if we are not getting any new state. And there will be the final solution. And here is the final DFA of the particular question. And we can see that here there are three final states, A, B and C. And on giving input 0, it is going on A, and on giving input 1, it's going on B. Like that, we can explain.
So here we are having some MCQ questions like application of finite automata and whether NFA can use empty string transitions.
Yeah.
And these all are some basic MCQs. So here we are concluding our presentation by stating some important points regarding NFA and DFA. So these are as follows. Every DFA is NFA, but every NFA is not always a DFA. There can be multiple final states in both NFA and DFA. DFA is used in lexical analysis in compiler. NFA is more of a theoretical concept.
Thank you very much. May I ask a few questions? Excellent presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Can a DFA without any final state, it is possible? Yes or no?
No, sir.
Yes. It is possible. A DFA without any final state. It is a DFA. All the transitions, but no final state. It is possible.
Sir, then no, it cannot accept anything.
Nothing, fine.
If there are no...
Yeah, that is it. You cannot, I can have a FSM which cannot accept anything. That's good. But that is a FSM. Please. What I say, even a non-accept state, it is not a must. Nobody say FSM must have accept state. It rejects everything, but it is a FSM. Okay. So, please, can a DFA, can a, from a NFA, can I have two DFA? Is it possible? Two DFA, is my question is clear? My question is, you have given a NFA, epsilon, with epsilon NFA, can a DFA design?
Yes, sir.
Can I have two?
We can design in two different ways. It depends on our designing.
Yeah.
Like
great.
We have minimization of DFA.
Yes.
So
yes.
There can be many DFAs.
No, that is not the thing. Whatever way you come, you have to minimization of DFA states. It will be unique DFA. Are you getting my point? DFA.
But initially, when we are converting from NFA to DFA.
Please listen. Whenever you have an NFA or with epsilon NFA, both are NFAs, your various techniques are there, one epsilon closure and all this, more or less same techniques. If you design a coming to a DFA, then you go for minimization of a DFA, okay? But that is the steps you require. Sometimes DFA have more number of states, so you have to minimize the number of states, but your transitions should be same. Your alphabet and final state should be same, and initial state. Then the DFA has to be unique. Please,
okay.
Please check it. You must check it. The DFA, every DFA, your state number may be different. State number may be once you have given A, B, C, another you say Q0, Q1, Q2, but A is Q0, B is Q1, C is Q2. Like, okay. I have understood, DFA has to be unique. That is the great thing of DFA. Okay.
Yes,
that
sir.
Is,
understood.
I think you can always argue. You can definitely go back and you can always see. I'm not saying I am always right. Another thing is that, can you have a DFA with, DFA, minimization of states, and with no output? In certain states and no output. Is it possible? That is a DFA in certain states transition, there is no output. Is it possible? Are you getting my question? It is the DFA, it is there, and the no output, that is also you can in minimization of steps. There is some techniques are there, two algorithms are there, you can put it. Okay. This is little bit another. Have you heard of what? Yeah, everything is fine. And another question I wish you can ask a question also. You can ask a question. It is a reverse. You can ask a question. Any question on DFA and NFA. And one thing you great mention in lexical analysis, DFA is highly used and the regular expression is used. Okay.
Yes. For getting tokens.
Yeah.
Yes,
for getting tokens. And the tokens will be stored in the symbol table. So you can ask instead of DFA, why you are not using a standard question? It will be asked, why not PDA? Because PDA is more powerful. And why not use a Turing machine? Turing is much more powerful. But the DFA is enough. So we should not put much machine hardware into this lexical analysis. Lexical analysis should be done by a DFA itself. And your TCP/IP communication is also another example of like HTTP protocol. It is a stateless protocol. This is also a good example of DFA. So DFA is highly used. Then what is the use of a non-deterministic FSM? What is the use of
it? It's easier that regular expressions.
Yes, it is easier to regularize.
Sometimes it is easier to use NFA than DFA.
Yes, sometimes, yes. But whenever you make a regular DFA, actually, can a DFA have any language? What is the language? Any DFA can accept the language. What is the name of the
regular
language? Regular expression.
Regular language.
Regular language.
Okay.
Can a regular language, I call it a context-free language?
Yes, sir, we can.
Yes, because context-free language is a superset of this. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for everybody, and give a presentation. I expect to give a presentation like this on Turing machine. That will be great enough. So, that's great. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Okay, sir. Thank you.